The molecular orbital theory and the valence bond theory are both very useful theories to explain the types of data that we gather from the laboratory. For example, the valence bond theory helps us understand the electronic geometries that are adopted by molecules when they have certain regions of high electron density around them. Further, then we can predict properly the molecular geometries. So the valence bond theory is very, very good for that. The molecular orbital theory is also good for predicting geometries. It's not quite as easy to visualize, but it is gives accurate energy levels for the electrons across a molecule. And the molecular orbital theory also allows us to see why certain compounds are paramagnetic while others are diamagnetic. So both theories are very powerful and useful when we're trying to develop for ourselves a model that can be predictive and also explain what we see. In some cases, it's valid to combine both theories to explain what we see. And this is the case when we have sp2 hybridization. It's useful to use both. And let me use benzene as an example. Benzene is a molecule, an organic molecule. It has the chemical formula C6H6. When we draw the structure for benzene, we draw a resonance structure, and we draw it this way. It's a six-membered ring with three double bonds. Now, before we go too much further, let me remind you that this is a shorthand way, what I've shown here, a shorthand way called a line drawing to represent this organic molecule. It's a very common method. You've probably seen it used before in your biology class, but it's a very common method for representing organic, that is carbon-based molecules. We assume carbons are at the corners every time you have a corner. You assume that all the octets have been satisfied for the carbons, so the hydrogens have been left off. If there's a double bond, you show it. But the hydrogens are just left off and assumed. So the full structure for benzene would be like this, where we show at every corner there's a carbon, and attached to every carbon there's a total of eight electrons, or the octet is satisfied. So we have a hydrogen here, one bond, another bond, and then a double bond here, and it's the same for every single carbon. This is just a shorthand way called the line drawing for representing an organic molecule. Now, to understand the behavior, the geometry, it's a planar molecule, and also some of the chemistries we'll see later on, it's useful to combine both the valence bond theory and the molecular orbital theory. If you look at the structure carefully, you'll see that each carbon has one, two, three regions of high electron density. So we expect sp2 hybridization around that carbon. And the sp2 hybridization, of course, gives us the trigonal planar structure, which is why we see that this molecule, C6H6, is a planar molecule. And so if you look at each carbon, and you see that each carbon has an sp2-sp2 overlap to form the carbon-carbon single bonds. So it's a sp2-sp2, a sigma bond formed all the way around here, 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 and here. And then the other sp2 is to the hydrogen bond, 1s, to form the single bond, sigma bond there as well. So that valence bond very nicely predicts the planar structure. Now, remember, this is a resonance structure, and when we say resonance, then we know that this Lewis structure, even this line drawing Lewis structure, is not a great representation, because we know that the bond energies tell us that each bond energy and each bond length is identical. So you can't have a single, double, but rather it's resonating somewhere in between. So the way we explain the resonance in these types of structures is to use the molecular orbital theory. Now remember, for the sp2, if we have sp2, then we have combined the 2s and two of the 2p to provide the sp, excuse me, to provide, to give us the sp2 hybrid orbitals. We still have a vacant p orbital that's not been hybridized. So on each one of these carbons, we have a p orbital, and that's what's shown in this drawing right here. It's the benzene, what we call ring, the sp2 hybridized orbitals have been left off so that you can see just the remaining p orbital. And what happens is, and what we know is that the bond, the pi bond that's formed by the side-on overlap is actually across the entire molecule, hence the need for the molecular orbital theory to explain it. So the six p atomic orbitals are overlapping completely across the entire molecule to give what we call this delocalized image or picture of the molecular, the pi bond, which is now considered a molecular orbital instead of individual valence bond model. So we have a delocalized picture of the pi orbitals here. Okay, and so what we think of is that the electrons are free to move either above or below the plane of the molecule within this extended molecular orbital, pi orbital, that is created from all six of these individual atomic orbitals overlap. So in this case, to truly understand benzene, we combine both the valence bond valence bond theory to understand the planar nature, and we with the molecular orbital theory to understand the delocalized nature of the pi electrons, which are now in a full molecular orbital above and below the plane. So that's why a lot of times you'll see benzene represented this way, with the ring in the middle. It's called a benzene ring, and this ring in the middle is indicating these delocalized electrons that exist in this molecular orbital, which is a pi orbital.